Hey guys, it's me, the Savvy Business Chick, making sure that you know your purpose and destiny in the marketplace. And you know what I'm talking about today, how to recruit and retain caregivers for your home care biz. Come on in. Hey, what's going on, guys? Thanks for joining. So, I told you guys I was going to talk about this subject today because I keep getting calls. I keep getting people emailing me. People want to know if you have a home care business, how do you recruit? How do you recruit? How do you retain these caregivers? And if you want to know, why am I approved to talk about this subject? It's because, hey, what's going on? Thanks for the shout out. Basically, you know, in 2006, I started a home care business, a skilled home care business, from scratch, from the ground up. And within 2 years, actually a little bit less than 2 years, like 20 months out of 24 months of 2 years, I grew that business into $3.3 million in revenue, and then it kept going up and up and up. And then now I am helping you. I'm helping aspiring and emerging business owners just grow their business and get stupid results. So if you like to get stupid results, then please join my home care CEO mentorship program. And if you're just an aspiring entrepreneur and you would like to, transfer your business idea into a business plan and see how you can really just get your business off the ground, I also have a smaller mentorship program for aspiring entrepreneurs. So that's a little bit of my housekeeping today. Thanks for joining today. In today's session of how to recruit and retain caregivers for your home care biz. Let me clean off this. Is that better? Okay. And how to recruit and retain caregivers for your home care biz. I am probably going to get to maybe only 3 or 4 of these tips before. How much are the two programs, if you don't mind me asking? You can go to my link in my bio and you can know, depending on. Hey, Crystal, that's my niece. She joined in. Thanks for joining, Niecy. So let me get to the training, because I definitely am the kind of person that I like to get straight to it. I told you guys I was going to give you guys some tips. I don't like there to be a long introduction. If you want to know more about me, if this is your first time joining in live, you know, please follow me. You'll learn all about me from my stories to my posts. But I want to go over, if you have a home care business, please let me know in the comments. A lot of times the comments don't transfer over on to the Instagram live. So let me know in the comments if you have a home care business. If you're thinking about starting a home care business, then these are some things you need to think about too, because a lot of businesses have failed because they did not know how to get workers. They did not know how to get, whether it's a caregiver or, hey, it's Cousin Christopher. Hey, thanks for joining. They did not know how to get people to go work these jobs. Like, so the first thing I want you to know is that, so waiting for your license approval, starting soon, cool. What state are you in? First thing I want you to know is that recruiting caregivers, so whether you have a medical home care business or a non-medical home care business, I want you to know that when you're recruiting your caregivers or your nurses, you should treat that like a marketing event. So, in these conversations and these lives that I'm giving you guys, I'm going to talk to you like you're my mentees, whether you're in my mentorship program or not. and I'll let you guys know if I'm gonna save this, if they save this, or give these nuggets to my mentees in their mentorship portal. I want you to treat anytime you are recruiting to your caregivers or nurses, it is a marketing event. They are your clients. A lot of home care business owners, CEOs, they do not treat their caregivers, their nurses, like their clients. And that is your first mistake. So you need to treat them like you're their clients. I'll explain later why. So if you have never recruited for home caregivers before, I'm just going to stick to caregivers so I don't have to keep jumping around to caregivers and nurses, then you may, you know, associate reaching out to them like you would reach out for a job. You'll say, okay, well, I put an ad up. They respond to the ad, right? Well, with caregivers, you have to be a little bit more creative. So I definitely recommend that you have a really good job post, and you put things in, you make sure you put the location. You just might as well just be truthful up front. If it's in a this is where I say your marketing, because your job post, you have to sell it, you know, like, because a lot of times these clients live in rural areas, or, you know, they live on the outskirts of the city. So you need to sell it. And it first starts with a job post. So maybe you put a job post on Craigslist. There are a lot of caregivers that apply for jobs on Craigslist. Don't say to yourself, oh, I wouldn't post a job on Craigslist. Craigslist is where all the creepy people hang out. No, you want to go where, hey, thanks for joining. You want to go where, you know, you want to go where the fish are. Basically, you're going fishing. In this instance, you're going fishing for caregivers, for workers. So if other agencies are doing it, you need to establish yourself there. Craigslist is a good place. Indeed is also a good place. Those are my top two for profiles. Of course, you can use monster.com as well. I have a list of other sites that I will be sharing with my mentees, so that because right now one of our objectives that we're doing and for my mentorship program is we are helping them to attract a whole new brand of caregivers. So that's one of the reasons why I wanted to share this with you guys. So get you guys to thinking, give you guys some free tips, be helpful and resourceful to you. So again, I'm going to repeat, you know, if you haven't, if you have marketed or tried to look for caregivers on Craigslist and you did not get a lot of good responses, then go back and check your job posts. Maybe it wasn't appealing. Remember, you have to market to them. You have to give them bait in the job description to make them want to apply. So Craigslist and Indeed are your top four job sites. Next, I definitely suggest that you use Facebook. Facebook a little bit more than Instagram, even though I can tell you guys how to market to caregivers using Instagram, but I prefer Facebook more so over Instagram for marketing to caregivers in home care. All right, so I gave you guys your sites where you're gonna be posted. So now we're gonna get into the creative part, the unorthodox of parts of recruiting to caregivers. And one thing I want to look at my note. Look, I wrote some stuff down. This is something I just worked with one of my mentees that's in Texas on. Again, it's all about marketing. I want you guys to host a marketing event call an application day. So do you remember back in the day, depends on how old you are, and you wanted a job, let's say you're in high school, you would go around to different maybe retail stores, you go to a bookstore, you go to maybe, you know, my female, go to Victoria's Secret, and you ask them, can you fill out an application? Well, I want you to promote it. So this is why I really said I prefer Facebook a little bit more than Instagram for this particular recruitment. Promote application day. If you're not familiar with home care, then you, or if you're not already operating your home care business, you may or may not know that the application process is very lengthy and a lot of people become discouraged. But what you, by having an application day where the person just comes in, they complete an application, and you're basically going to give them a speed interview. The speed interview, you have like maybe like five talking points, maybe five quick questions that can get their availability. They get a little bit of something about their experience, if they're willing to travel, a little bit about their personality, and how eager they are to work. Then the rest of the information you can get from the application, because you want them to complete the application completely. And if you don't have an application and you have a home care business, or you don't have a smooth onboarding application or recruitment plan, I am offering a audit. Well, I will audit your system for that and give you advice coaching. I have a 30-minute coaching session that I'm offering for July only. I'll mention at the end of this broadcast. So going back, application day. Now, you want to have it once a month for about 3 months. You want to do it for 90 days. So your first one is going to be bring them into your office. Then the second time you want to do this is that you want to go out in the community. So you want to, right now, like say here in the Washington DC area, you can't go inside of a Chick-fil-A. But back when you could go inside Chick-fil-A, I would say, you know, set up a booth. See, I have it in my notes. Set up a booth at a Chick-fil-A or a Dunkin' Donuts. Chick-fil-A or Dunkin' Donuts. So now we have to be creative because every state is different. So I want you to go out in the community and basically you have to announce it. This is again why I'm saying I like Facebook, because you're gonna say it's an event. Meet me here between this time and this time. Now you have to be really you have to be a good marketer. If you're the CEO or director of your company, because you're investing time going out. So it's easy when it's in your office and you're waiting for people to come to you. But when you go out to in the community and you set up shop, you say, meet me here. You know, sometimes people don't arrive on time. When you're at the office, you can still do work. You can, you know, talk to, you know, people, answer calls, you know, while you're waiting for people. But you know, you're basically going to say, between this time and this time, you know, give it a good 3 hours, come and complete your application. Then you have to take supplies with you. This is where I definitely recommend, if you were in my mentorship program or you're being mentored by me, that you definitely have promotional items like a pen that has your company's name, not only so that a person can complete the application, but because when, you know, everybody likes a pen, especially because most nurses or caregivers, they use a pen for writing their notes or anything else. Even though we have a lot of new technology where people are using tablets in home care, but everybody likes a good pen. You always need a pen for something, right? So then you give them that. That's a gift, and it has your phone number on it. So it's also encouraging them to follow up with you. So you have the application. Thanks for joining. You do it a speed interview. Again, if you would like me to, I will help you with, you know, how to really just get some good information very quickly, have them complete the application all the way. So you're not doing a traditional interview where you're going through the whole thing. Oh, I see you worked here, blah, blah, blah. No, we're going to say that for later. We want to collect. The main purpose of the application day is to collect information. Hence, the application is going to tell the name, the address. Hopefully your application, you know, has the person put their work experience, their pay history, and the hours they're available. So you're going to collect that information. Then you're going to talk to them. You're going to get to know them a little bit, break the ice, see if they could possibly come to, you know, a full orientation day. And then you're going to, at the end, you're going to ask for a commitment. Company pins are good. It's definitely good or advertising, Stephen. So you're going to ask for, would you be willing to come boom, boom, boom on this day for our orientation? So you get the chance to see them face to face, ask them that question. And so then you have assignment for either yourself or someone in your office to follow up with all of these people that said they are available for this whatever interview date. And sorry, it was a little net right there. So that's a part I forgot to mention. When you set up these application days, you want to already have another date already lined up that's set that you want to ask someone to commit to complete the whole process. You will know during the speed interview if this is somebody you even want to come to your office to complete the whole process, right? And so the first time it's going to be at your office, and the second two times are going to be at two different areas. These two different areas that you will go out in the community, either you'll set up a booth, or you'll go to a popular location where you can be, and they're not going to say, hey, you can't sit here, and have people meet you. And then another thing would be to go to where some new, like CNAs or HHAs will be coming out of training. Go there and basically ask the instructor, ask the administrator if you can talk to that group about your company and opportunities in home care. So then you'll still have them fill out an application, but that application, so the third time you do that, will be a little bit different. That will be more like an information sheet, because you may know that they don't have as much experience, so that you know in, let's say, 2 months, 6 months, let's say they're about to graduate, that you have some people that's coming out that you can call and that will be available for your clients, okay? So that's my second tip on recruitment. I said, make sure you're listed on the appropriate platforms. And then the second is my application day at those three different areas. Sorry, I'm a little stuffy, guys. Okay, I'm like looking at my notes right here. I'll give you two more tips, and then for recruitment, and then we'll move on to retention. If you guys have any questions, please feel free to drop your questions below. So, before COVID, you know, every time I moved around, I would always, you know, bump into a nurse. Whether it's at the CVS, at the grocery store, maybe getting coffee. So my next tip for you, if you are, you know, the CEO, you're the business owner, is to carry around business cards, but not just your regular business cards. I would advise you, remember I said I want to talk to you like you're my mentee, like we're having a private session, one-on-one session right now, I would advise you to create a special business card or flyer. The reason why I said business card, because if you're a male, then it's easy to carry it in your pocket and your wallet. And if you're a female, you know, it's also easy for you to carry it in your pocket or wallet. And that business card is going to be a marketing tool for if you see a nurse out in the community, and here's what you should do. Now, I would run into nurses out in the community. How did I know they were a nurse? I asked. I saw someone in scrubs, and it's all kinds of people that wear scrubs. It's people that work in a dentist's office that wear scrubs. You have to ask to find out. And if they say, you know, you say you're at the grocery store, you see somebody in scrubs, like, hi, I'm just curious, are you a nurse or do you work in healthcare? This is my whole conversation. Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. I'm only asking because I work with nurses or I work with caregivers. So if they say yes, that's my response. I work with caregivers. They're like, oh, okay. Then give a compliment, right? This is marketing, guys. This may not seem like it. This is marketing. You give a compliment. Oh, okay. So you're telling them, you're asking a question. In marketing, that's called qualifying. You're qualifying the person you're talking to. So without getting too heavy, that's a part of target marketing. You're qualifying. You're saying, okay, you're exactly who I need to talk to, who I need to market to. Then you let them know why you're asking. Remember, I said, oh, I'm only asking because, you know, I work with nurses. Don't in this situation be all puffy and be like, yeah, because I'm the boss and I hire nurses. Just tell them you work with nurses. You work with caregivers. Oh, okay. You know, then always say you can get more bees with honey than you can with other stuff, right? I've got the whole quote. So you want always give a compliment. That's my number one tip to females who find it difficult to network. When, you know, back when I was going to a lot of networking events, always give a compliment. Okay, I really appreciate what you're doing. You know, out in the community, especially with COVID, are you open to you know, other work opportunities? Card. I'm only asking because the company that I work for. So here, that's what I'm trying to tell you guys, even if you're a CEO, at that moment, I want you to put on your marketer hat or your HR hat. You're not the CEO right there, because I can tell you guys that sometimes, and this is something I learned from my first mentor, sometimes when you tell somebody you're the CEO, and it cannot necessarily be good. I'm the CEO when I'm around other CEOs. When I'm around other people, I'm just Sean. I'm just a savvy business chick. I'm whoever I need to be in that situation, because your goal is to get them to come apply for your job. So if they think, oh, she just looking out for me, or he just looking out for me, and yeah, they, you know, my company, you know, I have a couple of these cards, you know, you can call this number, and they're always hiring. You gave them a card. Like I said, I could help you make a business card that is marketing that would attract caregivers. And then you leave it like that. You were out in the community and you spoke directly with somebody that could possibly call. And then you make sure you either tell them, or it says in the car, you know, tell them that you spoke with Sean. So I always had someone. So when they called the HR, thanks for the hearts. When they called the HR, I had them. That was the code. Oh, they spoke with Sean. So then they know they got a business card, right? I am a very unorthodox business person and marketer. So when I say take a business card and use it as a marketing tool to attract and recruit caregivers, we tend to do what we're told to do when we can just use the same format and just have the company logo on one side and on the other side just have hiring nurses, hiring caregivers, and have like a bulleted where they can just see, you know, everything they need to do to join your company. And instead of just, you know, we only use a business card for what they told us to. But what I'm telling you to, as a business mentor, is to, you know, be unorthodox. Use it for different reasons. And whether you're in a home care business or not, you're always, if you find that you're always running to someone who is a potential client, then you need to have something to physically give them. Because not everybody's going to go to your website. Not everybody's going to go to your social media pages. So stop them in their tracks. Hey, can I give you something real quick? You got it in your hand. They have it in their hand. Okay? So I'm going to have to get you guys to remind me tomorrow, because I'm going to have to get back on here tomorrow and do the second half. We talked about making sure you're on the appropriate sites. We talked about application day. And then I'm looking at my notes. See, carry around business cards or postcard flyer. Here is my next and last recruitment. Oh yeah, I do. I work with entrepreneurs in other states. Thanks for, here's my last tip on recruitment, and then I'm going to go into retention. Okay. And let me know if these, ideas, if these strategies are sparking, you know, something in you guys that are like, dang, I didn't even think about it like that. And then, hopefully you'll go and do some of these things so, that you can be successful in your business. Okay, so like I said, depending on what state you're in, when I said, you know, set up a booth somewhere, that may not be available everywhere. And know your client. So remember I said recruiting is marketing. So know your client. If you had to set up at a Popeyes, it's okay. If Popeyes is open and you had to set up at a Popeyes, don't be so dignified that you're like, oh no, my business, we have to be at a hotel and blah, blah, blah. But if your caregiver goes to Popeyes and you're like, okay, meet me here, you know, then do what works, basically. That's in short. So my last tip for recruitment is, after carrying around a business card, is there are a lot of grocery stores. Thank you. I'm glad that it has you thinking. There are a lot of grocery stores, guys. Starbucks. There are a lot of places that have bulletin boards. There are a lot of places that have bulletin boards. And actually, if you're smart and savvy, like I think you are, because you're on this platform, what I want you to do is to, and if you're going to do this this strategy, look up. You can do a search of bulletin boards in my area, and what you'll do is you'll create a flyer. You'll create a flyer, and that flyer will be to market to caregivers, and you'll have a picture of them. Because a picture is worth 1,000 words, so we gotta have good pictures, right? And then you'll have the information of what you gotta make it short and sweet, what you're looking for, the benefit of them working with you. So you gotta give a benefit. If you, in all of your marketing, you can't just say, well, they need a job. What's the benefit? Sometimes benefits are you saying we pay weekly. That's a benefit. So whenever you put stuff like that on your on your marketing for caregivers, that's immediate attraction. If you don't pay weekly, you know, then say, be creative and say we pay fast. just be creative with your marketing on that flyer. And then old school, guys, old school, have you ever seen the flyers that have like the little slits? So then it would have the little slit on it, so they would take one, and it actually has to say take one, so that they would take it off and they would have your phone number, right? I shop at Costco. I'm an executive business member at Costco, and I found out that Costco, you know, will allow you to, you know, post stuff there. So is it likely that your caregiver shops at Costco? No, they may shop at a regular grocery store, but just know that maybe your client or potential client shops at Costco or shops at some of these places where you are marketing to your caregivers, and they see the name of your company and they say, wow, I never heard about them, but I'm gonna give them a call. So any marketing that you do, do it with the client who is the caregiver in mind, but just know that other people may see it. Other people, like your potential client patients that they're going to serve. And so I always encourage you to do that with excellence. Do things with excellence, even if you're going to Popeyes. Okay. Okay. So now for the recruitment, retaining of client side. And again, if you have any questions, please drop them in the comments. Retaining caregivers. Okay, I got this question a lot recently. People have been signing up for my 10-minute chat. It's a the link is in my bio. So if you've never spoken to me before and you want to get some information, you want to have a quick chat about your business. You want to tell me something that you want to start, or you want to ask a question, I have a free consultation call a 10-minute chat. It's a one-time use, guys, so I always say when you get on there, make it good, and let me know what you may need help with. Again, a link is in my bio, and a lot of people ask this question, and I gave those people specific customized advice for their company. And I'm sharing this with you, that if you're having problem retaining caregivers, it's probably because you haven't established a good company culture. What is company culture? Company culture is a pretty new phrase that is mostly used in corporate America. And if I can just break it down, it's like what Chick-fil-A does, you know. All of their workers, they dress the same, they have the same greeting, they're going to give you that same kind of experience. So it's your caregiver's experience with your company. And that could be, they could be having a problem with somebody in the office when they come in the office, or if they have to call the office, maybe they feel disrespected. Maybe they feel like you're not giving them good cases, or maybe they don't feel like their voice is being heard. What I'm suggesting you do is your first tip for retaining caregivers is, just like you do a client satisfaction survey, I want you to do a caregiver or employee satisfaction survey. I can help you, show you how to set that up, what kind of questions you should ask, whether you should do do it online, or whether you should, you know, if some of them pick up paper checks, put it in their check, or whether you should have some of your staff call and, you know, ask some of these questions, or maybe you should do it as a CEO. What it does is it's always good for you to have information. Information helps you make decisions, it helps you problem solve. So you get the information and you basically ask them, you know, what's making them happy, what's making them not happy. When someone feels like they're being heard, then they're more likely to stay around and they may give some good ideas. So I suggest you do the employee satisfaction survey and just basically start hearing from your staff, and then take some of those ideas that's on that from that feedback and implement them. Another thing that I would recommend you do is somewhat like an employee of the month, but I would make it like a caregiver of the month. Again, because I said that recruiting and retainment is a marketing event, then you should put marketing money behind it. You should create a budget monthly for appreciation, for acknowledging caregivers. And I would even get your clients involved. A lot of times clients feel guilty because they know their caregivers are with them more than they're with their family. So if you say, hey, here's a way where you can acknowledge your caregiver, and maybe they'll get like a $50 card to, you know, such and such restaurant, or they'll get a gas card somewhere, you know, we can come up with some different rewards that will make them feel appreciated, then that client slash client's family will like that, A, the company is doing that, and then B, that they contributed to them receiving that reward. So the first thing is to get feedback from the actual caregiver, the actual worker. The second thing is to create a regular rewards program. Hey, thanks for joining. Hey, Tyreek, thanks for joining. Create a regular rewards program. Not only did I do stuff like caregiver or nurse of the month, but for Nurse Week, I had nurse rewards. At our annual Christmas party, we had rewards there. And I don't know if you guys know how easy it is to go to Staples or go to Office Depot and buy a box of certificates and print them out and, you know, have your staff or your managers or your supervisors come up with categories that you're going to acknowledge people on an annual or by event basis. So you definitely need to have a reward system so that people will feel appreciated. If you're not able to pay the highest rate, you know, in town, you know, because some new home care CEOs, that's how they get nurses. That's how they get caregivers. They say, oh, we'll pay you a dollar more than the other agency. But you can retain good workers, good reliable workers, by just acknowledging them and appreciating them regularly. Sometimes that may be a card. Maybe you can do something for birthdays. And this is simple, but not a lot of people do it. And when you start doing it, please commit to doing it regularly. If you want to do birthdays, you know, if you ever worked in the office, you know, back in the day, we acknowledged birthdays, all of July birthdays, once a month. They bought a cake, we sung happy birthday. So, you know, how much would that cost for you to do something like that, or to even just send that caregiver a birthday card? So just to say, I acknowledge you, I appreciate you, happy birthday. So that's why I say you got to have a marketing budget for these ideas. And if you, when the Bible says count the cost, right? And what that means in this situation is, instead of looking at, oh, if I do all these ideas, this is going to cost me, let's say, $250 a month. That's low. It can cost $1,000 a month. It can cost $5,000 a month. What will be the cost of you losing a reliable caregiver that, you know, really takes off and makes the client happy? And once they heard that that caregiver left, they're leaving your company. So that's why this area cannot be ignored. You really have to, you know, put some thought into it and make it a plan. So it goes from the idea stage to the plan. My last tip for you guys to use. Looking at my notes. This should have actually been mentioned back with the recruitment, but it works for the retainment too. Make good hiring decisions. So, and that includes make good firing decisions. So, I know we're talking about retaining people, but sometimes, if you ever heard a bad apple spoils the bunch, there have been times, especially in home care with like personal care aides, that one person wasn't doing the work, so you send another caregiver in, and then everybody's complaining because, you know, she's doing or he's doing what they're supposed to do, and they just got slack. In home care, people tend to fizzle out. They tend to burn out. They stay on cases too long, and it's your responsibility as the CEO, as the owner, to have your team catch those things. And sometimes you should be catching it initially hiring, and then other times you catch it with the during that your annual review. Don't be afraid to lose good workers. Some people, they don't want to be a CNA forever, so they're going off to get more schooling to, you know, become an LPN or become an RN. Celebrate them, support them, make sure that your company culture is, here's a place you can grow. Even though I don't have another role for you to play, maybe after you finish this degree, you can come work in the office. This is the kind of conversations you should be having with them, and they need to hear from you as a CEO regularly. And I say do that, you know, by having like maybe like an annual address, you know, just like how, you know, the president has the State of the Union. You can have an annual address at a Christmas party or during an awards ceremony, or maybe quarterly you send them out an email or a letter and letting them know what's on your heart, and that you heard some of the things that they shared in their survey, in their questionnaire. So those are my tips for how to recruit and retain home care caregivers in your home care business. I might lead this up so you guys can check it out. But I gave some customized strategies to some of the people that called me. And if this is an area that you're struggling with, and you are a home care owner, and like basically specifically people ask me for how to do onboarding and then how to recruit. So I got like separate that I'm doing a special this month. If you're in my mentorship program, you automatically get this training and these resources. But if you are not in and you want to try out what mentorship is with my program, I have a special for July only for $77 for 30 minutes. You know, I like the commercial one that Geico used to say, what would 15 minutes and, well, this is for this instance, 30 minutes and great advice. But you can only pick one area that I will audit and give you great advice so that you can help you improve. And that's my offer for July. I'm going to come back on here tomorrow, give you guys some more tips, some more information on how you can recruit and retain caregivers. So bye for now. And that link is in the bio if you're interested in getting that audit for your home care business. Bye for now.